Welcome, everyone. I am so delighted to see so many in our community here tonight in what I believe will be the first public forum meeting between a president of Washington College and Chestertown's incumbent mayor ever held. And so we're thrilled that you can join us for this historic event. Before we start, I want to emphasize a point that the spy made last week in our editorial, that collaboration and renewal projects in general, whether they be on campus or in a downtown, are really complicated and really hard to pull off. And there are no easy answers. And as a result, I want to pay particular tribute to these true terrific leaders who are willing to share tonight what their hopes are for our community. And I just want to welcome them again. Thank you. And just to show you how we are totally committed to this community, all three of us are alumni of Dancing with the Stars for Horizon. We have a very limited amount of time today. I guess we're getting a little bit of feedback, but and we want to talk a lot about many things. So I want to move forward with my our questions. But before I do, I would like to have Sheila and Chris kind of give a summary of where their institution is at a particular time. And maybe, Madam President, we could start
with
you.
Sure, yeah. Well, I think we're on a good trajectory. You know, we were just reviewing that. We've made some real progress just in the last year on improving our retention rates from freshmen to sophomores. That's a very important metric for college presidents, because whenever a student comes here, I want to make sure they graduate. And if you lose them, it's generally between the first and second year. So we were actually able to bump that up by 4 percentage points last year, which was tremendous. And thanks to people like Ann Horner and Andrea Tashusi, our advancement, our philanthropic operation has really significantly improved. We're actually awarded by CASE, recognized by CASE as the most improved advancement operation nationally last year. So I think those are all good things. Our ranking's going up. I hate managing the college to ranking, but let's face it, parents generally look at those, especially those U.S. News and World Report rankings. So we're going to keep working on that. Again, that's geared heavily towards graduation rates. So making sure we're recruiting students who will succeed here, giving them all the support they need, that's really so essential to the college and its future. And to the community that we are a part of. You know, I'm sure you all have read that high school demographics are not good these days, so the high school population is shrinking in the Mid-Atlantic area. It's actually declining nationwide, but it's particularly acute in the Mid-Atlantic region. And so we really need to focus on not only bringing great students in, but making sure they stay. Because that's important. That's also important to our budget and our ability to fully participate. We're also growing our international population for a lot of reasons. It's tremendously enriching for the campus and for our domestic students, and I love the way they blend together and learn from each other. But that's also important because of the challenging demographics here. So I do think we're on a very good trajectory, but there are a lot of challenges that lie ahead. Our students typically borrow more than the average in Maryland. So our students graduated about $34,000 of student debt. That was down from $36,000 the year before. So I was very proud of the fact that we were able to get that down. But that's still, I think the state average for four-year college is $27,000. So we are a bit high, and so we're working hard on our affordability initiatives to make sure this great program we offer is accessible to a wide range of students. And that's a good investment, it really is. And so I think we're gonna continue to grow, we're gonna continue to build this great academic program, we're gonna continue to raise our ranking, which is, you get into a virtuous cycle, you get more students, the more your ranking goes up. But there are a lot of challenges. But I do think, you know, my job is the college and Chris's job is the town, but obviously there's some mutual interest there. We are the largest employer in Chestertown. So the more we can grow in a sustainable way, the more we can hire great faculty and staff to support our students, and that, again, fuels into the economy. Our philanthropy is so important to maintaining our buildings. We spend about $6 or $7 million a year on maintenance, and that, again, flows into the community because we typically use local contractors, and also in a smart way, we're doing some new construction on the waterfront. We'll probably invest, if we hit our fundraising goals, you know, close to $25 million on the waterfront between the new academic building and the new boathouse, and we're reviewing options on the armory. So that's probably more than you wanted, but I do think we're on a very good trend line. We're growing, we're improving, we're getting national recognition for some of our programs, but there are serious challenges that lie ahead.
No, thank you.
Yeah, sure.
Appreciate it. Mr. Mayor.
That was good. That was good stuff. My turn.
Yes.
So I've been mayor for 3 years, 3 months, and I think 11 days as of right now. Not that anybody's counting or anything, but we've had a lot going on. I think when I took office, the town had kind of gotten a reputation as being not business friendly. So we really tried to hammer away at that in a variety of ways. We had some business forums where we just invited business owners from various commercial districts to come talk to us, tell us what drove business into their stores. Was there anything the town was doing that was inhibiting their ability to do business? And that was kind of a neat way to kind of get the door open, get that dialogue started. We've undertaken a lot of neat capital projects in the 3 years that I've been in office. Just to name a few, we finally, after a couple years of delay, paved out the third leg of the rail trail. After several years of delays, we finished and built out Gateway Park at the end of the rail trail to serve as recreational amenities for that part of town and also as a trailhead for the railway area. We just finished building a new community park called Ajax, which is almost at the terminus of the rail trail in town, with some playground equipment for kids. We got a $220,000 grant and worked with the Kent County Board of Education, the Kent County Commissioners, and the staff at the middle school to completely revamp and rebuild their entire outdoor campus, which is one of my favorite projects. We built a 42-space new parking area on Cannon Street. We also, and this is probably the most important of all, really modernized, upgraded, and increased the size of our police station, which when I got the tour of our existing police station a couple months into my job, it was a real eye-opener. That was probably 20 years overdue. And then from an economic development standpoint, we have a lot of balls in the air as well. For downtown, we worked with the state to get an arts and entertainment district designation, basically a tax incentive program to encourage building owners to make improvements on their facilities. Also encourages artists to create art in the district, which they can then sell as a tax write-off. And as a big part of that, we are able to hire Kay McIntosh, who I believe is actually sitting right over there, as a full-time marketing and economic development coordinator. That's really important for me because I have a full-time job, so I can't be in every storefront nearly as much as I'd like. So Kay, in that capacity, has been absolutely awesome as an ambassador to the business community, especially downtown, for the town government. And she's also helped revive the Main Street Maryland program in Chestertown, which essentially creates committees of volunteers, local stakeholders, to revitalize things in the downtown area. And lastly, but definitely not least, probably the biggest economic development initiative currently underway is the town annexed about 70 acres, the old Walmart property, just on the other side of Washington Plaza there. And also created an enterprise zone working with the county and the state, which basically gives entrepreneurs tax incentives to set up shop in Chestertown. And partly as a result of those efforts, Dixon Valve / KRM, which is really kind of the same thing, is really in the running with the planning stages of creating a new national headquarters for Dixon, which will help retain about 350 jobs in the town and the county, but will also potentially create a new business park that could bring hundreds of new jobs to the town. So those are all things that are happening around the community. If you want to know why I have so many gray hairs after just 3 years and this receding hairline, it's this last item on my list is the Chestertown Marina, which probably the most ambitious capital undertaking I think the town has probably ever done. It's a multi-million dollar project. It's a very complicated project. It involves a lot of design and planning and engineering, not to mention fundraising. But the good news is, and you may have seen this, we were able to get $1.1 million total from the state legislature, and $500,000 of that was really through the Senate's capital budget, and Senate President Mike Miller was really instrumental in helping that happen, and my contact to him was directly through President Sheila Bair, so she really stepped up and helped establish that connection.
My pleasure.
You know, I think that's just a fantastic example of if we both have similar goals and paths to achieve those goals, there really can be collaborative opportunities like that that are very meaningful on the ground and also on a financial level, but also philosophically, it's neat when the town and the college are on the same page as well.
Well, I mean...
Is that enough?
Yeah, that's enough to start with. I think that the question to you, Chris, is as you look at Sheila's ambitions or the college's ambitions for the waterfront, where do you think the town could help the college
It's an interesting question. I'd be willing to examine any way that we could help, because anything that happens from really their existing boathouse to Radcliffe Creek will be a tremendous improvement over what's been there for the last how many years. It's been just kind of open land that's really not contributing anything to the town. So anything that they want to do is something that I'm going to support, whether that's co-applying for grants, whether that's trying to, you know, work with them to list things that are important to the town. I know in our comprehensive plan, for example, one of the most interesting things about the college's waterfront ambitions is creating a waterfront promenade that traverses through the marina, through Wilmer Park, all the way through the college land, and then kind of doubles back into the historic district. Working collaborative on things like that, that I think would bring people to their campus, but would also create a really neat critical mass of cool things for visitors to Chestertown to see and do, and residents. So I think there's a lot of areas like that, whether that's, again, going for money collaboratively or just sitting down and banging out important parts of the planning process that are important to the town and the college. I think there's a lot of room there to run together.
Let me put that to you. I mean, you are a neighbor of in North Chestertown.
Right.
There's a lot of things going on up on this side of town as well,
right,
as downtown.
Right.
Where do you think you could work with the town?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think clearly the waterfront is an area of potential collaboration. And as we evaluate potential uses for Armory, we may need to talk with you all about, you know, different uses than maybe were originally contemplated. But I agree with Chris. I think we need to do something, right? And so, you know, so I think that's important, and we're very, very focused on that right now. I think on the northern part of the town, we have some property north of campus, which we would like, and that's a conversation Chris and I have been having off and on. I know some history to that, but we've been approached by Wawa to put a store in there, and so that's something that I hope we could have an open conversation about. I think it would create... I asked them about, you know, it would create about 35 jobs, pretty good paying jobs. You know, they generate significant tax revenue and income. And I like it because it's a great store. It's healthy food. You know, the kids would be proximate to campus, and that would be an easy place for them. They get the munchies in the middle of the night to go to. They wouldn't have to go a long distance. So that might be an area that we could talk about as well. And I think, you know, that would generate revenues that could help us, it could help the town, because it, you know, again, that's another piece of property that's been sitting vacant for a long time that's really just not contributing to the economy at all. So that's another, we don't talk as much about that part of town because all the growth is on the waterfront, but I think there again, that's one of the reasons why we'd be interested in trying to find a different use for that property, because clearly we're going the other direction now, whatever the original intention might have been. And I think in terms of, you know, putting, I think they'd be open to putting a parkland in. I mean, I think there are a lot of things aesthetically they would be happy to discuss. So I'm hoping we could have a good conversation about that. You know, but I'm excited about the waterfront. I'm excited about the promenade, the visitor center. I don't know, Chris, love to talk with you about that, whether we could.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, we want another really exciting thing that we're doing is something called the Eastern Shore Food Lab. I don't know, probably a lot of you have heard of Bill Schindler, one of our famous faculty members, of our many famous faculty members. But he does these amazing things with the primitive preparation of food. It really, you know, whether it's bug tacos or skinning deers or whatever, it's pretty amazing. And so we'd like to build a program around that, maybe have a tasting center downtown. And so there might be some synergies with how the town wants to build out the waterfront, and to the extent you're trying to draw tourists, you know, and having novel things that could draw visitors, that might be another area of collaboration that we'd love to pursue. So, I think the best thing we can do is focus on growth, right? I think that's our sweet spot. That's where we work together best, when we focus on growth. Not I'm going to grab something of yours, you're going to grab something of mine. That how can we work together to achieve growth? Growth of the college, growth of the town, responsible, healthy growth. And so that's really where I think Chris has brought such a fresh leadership perspective. in his short time as mayor. He's done some amazing things already. Really, hats off to him.
Let me ask a little bit on the reverse side. I mean, what would you like out of the town that would make the process of your projects go fast or more expedient? There is kind of real and then imagined.
Well, I think with anything, it's communication. I think it's open-mindedness. I think in the past, I feel good about relations. I'm with you. I think I've been told in the past it wasn't. And so you kind of have these visceral reactions, no, whatever you're going to do, no, because, we don't like you, we're not getting along. And so we're so beyond that. And so I think we're not always going to agree, but just having open communications and understanding each other's perspective and why we think this would be good for the town or the campus or collectively a positive thing. I think that's really what we need to do. And Chris and I, we haven't had our sessions at Evergreen recently, but Chris and I do try to periodically get together and just talk one-on-one, and I think those have been healthy things, and would like to continue them. I really just think it all comes down to communication.
And that's to you as well. I mean, do you find that there could be ways in which the college could be more engaged in what you all are doing as a municipality?
It's always an interesting conundrum. I totally get how the college sometimes gets tunnel vision, because it's a lot of work to keep a college of this size in a very rural area with a liberal arts focus. That's a lot of work to keep that viable, to keep it afloat. And, so anything we can do to help with that process is definitely worth our while. In terms of the college assisting, honestly, our biggest challenges are always going to be financial. Whenever, we basically have, let's use nice round numbers, about a $4 million a year budget. By the time I'm done paying my police force and our street crew and the staff at Town Hall, that's 95% of our income spent before I even have a chance to try to do anything fun or cool. So when I say we did a park at, Gateway Park or the rail trail, that's almost never coming out of our budget. It's coming out of grants that we go outside of our budget to find, because we're crimped. So when the college can, use their connections to help us get grants to do the marina, that's a huge help for us, because there's no way I would ever be able to write a $500,000 check from our general fund to make improvements at the marina. That's only going to happen if the legislature supports us and if the college can help us get connected to the people that make decisions in the legislature. That's a real tremendous way they can help. I think that would be the main thing, just collaborating on big initiatives like that, where we, just need as many voices supporting us. When the college throws its weight behind something, people in Annapolis know who they are. They employ 400 people. You have a gorgeous campus. It's a force. It's a force of nature, and it makes us go from a really tiny town to a town and a college working together, and that's impressive to someone considering who to give the money to in the state level.
Would you like to have the college have more of a presence downtown, for example?
I think that would be nice, yes. I know that the Center for Environment Society, for example, is moving their main operations to Cross Street, right next door to Sultana's new building, and I think that's awesome. I do think that sometimes the college has gone to great lengths, and this isn't just at Washington College, this is in colleges nationwide. It's almost like an arms race to get these kids to accept your offer. You make these gorgeous campuses that are so amazing, the kids never need to leave, and a lot of them never do. I was just at a Phi Delta Theta. I'm a Phi Delta from UVA, and it was the 25th anniversary of Phi Delta Theta on campus, and I actually got invited to talk to the kids, and some of the alumni came back, and they said to me, they were like, yeah, when we were here, we loved the college, and I had no idea the town was actually so cool. I was like, yeah, I think that's a compliment, but yeah. So anyway, and I remember having this conversation with Mitchell Reese, having this conversation with Jay and others. Like, what can the town do to get more students down here? And I'm like, they're your students. Maybe if you put a storefront downtown and they had to go downtown, that would make them go downtown. So I think there are ways that the college could increase their presence. You could walk around downtown prior to CES. And really have no idea that there's a college half a mile up the hill. And I think there are very easy, concrete ways to change that. That's one of the reasons, in addition to building up the waterfront in a nice way, getting the kids through the town to the waterfront, just having them go through there and see what's there And just increasing that visibility would help generate more visitation, I would think. I've always thought that the college kids that I know, and I don't know a lot of them, but the ones that have the best experience are the ones that have the most well-rounded experience, that do go downtown for First Fridays and volunteer at local organizations. They really get a lot out of it. Not that the others don't, but I think they get more. Yeah. So any way that the college can work to get more kids downtown, I think they've done that, actually. I know in your orientation weeks, mm-hmm. I see big groups of kids going around the town, which I didn't see 10 or 15 years ago, and I think that's really important. I know I talked to the incoming freshman class.
Yeah, it was great.
And I love doing that kind of stuff and just saying, hey, I'm your mayor. You know, yeah. There's a guy called the mayor, and he kind of like helps run the town. And I'm the guy, and I live right down the road. You can see my house from here.
So be quiet at night.
Breaking those barriers, Dave. It's all about breaking down barriers. Yeah.
And how about yourself? I mean, in terms of the Washington College, do you feel like you know, you would want the town to be more proactive
Well, I think we do have an amazing attendance at our, you know, our speaking events and our musical events, and so I do think, and I think and hope that the town appreciates that. I would also like to get more students downtown and have it more of a college town type of an atmosphere. I do think some of the waterfront development will help. The new boathouse will have kind of hanging out space, right? So we'll have a deck and hopefully an outdoor fireplace. And I hear this from students. They would like a place to hang out downtown. And so, you know, when we have a new academic building, that's still a few years down the road, but that will have lab space and research and classroom space. So students will be coming down there for a research experience. And the Army, too, we're still, you know, kind of the thinking is wide open in terms of what the Army would be, but we just sent out an RFP last year to solicit creative ideas on what we could do with the Armory, and one, actually the architect that did the Centerville Armory came back with some ideas to make it a residence hall, maybe perhaps with combined uses in the summertime. And so we're looking at that, we're trying to figure out, well, what students want to be, you know, given that the main campus is so far away, would they like doing that? But I think if we did it, and again, very preliminary idea, you know, if you all have feedback or thoughts, let me know an hour later. But it would be probably for seniors, and so those would be the students who would be more likely to go downtown for dinners and things like that. We probably wouldn't have dining services. It would just be a canteen or something like that. So again, you know, you'd be talking about 50, 60 students living there who would probably be at night having dinner or shopping at the little organic grocery store, which I always go to. So we haven't decided anything, but I am trying to brainstorm uses that will also increase student presence on the waterfront, which again will bring them into the downtown area.
Could you see in the future taking non-academic positions and repositioning them downtown? You know, when your first day on the job, the finance office kind of went up in smoke.
Yeah, no kidding. Yeah, it sure did. Well, you know, it is inconvenient for the staff because I'm in Bunting and those people in particular are seeing me a lot, so you know they're going back and forth. But it's certainly something to think about. You know, those discrete functions where there is not some job that require going back and forth four or five times a day, that's probably would be too difficult. But there may be other discrete functions that we could think about. And again, the Station Shore Food Lab, I think, again, this is very preliminary, but I think that would be great. You know, yeah. I think that would be, Bill is great. The kinds of things he would have in his tasting room, I guarantee you, would be novel and fascinating. And I do think that would give us an even bigger presence, but also not just draw students, but tourists. You know, people travel to eat, right?
Yeah.
And they're always interested in new food experiences.
Yeah. Fair enough. So the other thing that I wanted to explore, and I use the model of a economic development corporation, but it could be a task force or a mm-hmm. workforce. What can rekindle this relationship? Because I think that we have a lot of ideas, and I'm sure the audience has ideas too, but how do we move this forward? Because these are two very different independent structures that have to kind of work collaboratively.
Right. Yeah. Well, some of the history of that predates me. I saw, you had a great column, by the way, for this symposium, which I really appreciated. And I thought it well described, you know, some of the things we're dealing with right now. So I'm open to that. I mean, I think a more structured, like an economic development committee or something like that, I would be happy to participate in that. I think, at least my experience in the past has been the optimal structure is kind of a smaller group, because you want something that will, you want to get a lot of broad feedback, but then you want a small decision-making body so you can make decisions. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I mean, given the cluster, relatively small cluster of large employers in the town and other economic contributors, I think, you know, having a small core group that would kind of take it as their mandate to look in a holistic way where the growth opportunities are, how we can work together, I think that's a great idea. Yeah. Definitely. Yeah.
What do you?
I think, I don't know, this might have, is this working?
Yep.
I think it's an interesting idea. My take on that is I feel like those smaller groups, these economic development corporations in this town would be driven primarily by, you know, personalities. And so it's really important on groups like that to make sure you have a continuity in the group. And I also feel like it may be duplicating a lot of other things that are already happening. I mean, the town already has a marketing and economic development coordinator. The county already has a marketing and economic development coordinator in Jamie Williams. We've also got the Chamber of Commerce. So I'm amenable to the idea as long as they have a very defined mission that isn't just duplicating what other folks are already trying
That's
to
great.
Do. I have, you know, I really don't know a lot about economic development corporations. I was Googling this yesterday when you gave me this list. And there were some really cool examples where basically it's a nonprofit and groups raised money to help with facade improvements downtown. Now that I could really get behind because we need that big time. I think of like Jane's Church and some of these gorgeous historic structures that just need a little, basically they need the money. And if there was a group of, you know, well-connected individuals that were altruistic and very civic-minded that would be willing to raise money for that, I would be all about it. Or maybe they're into raising money and buying commercial space and setting up incubator spaces for small businesses to set up shop. You know, that would be something that would get me really fired up because I think that's something that's needed. You know, I keep telling people, like, people are like, what are you going to do to bring jobs to Chestertown? And I keep trying to explain, like, we're not the federal government. We're the mayor and council of Chestertown. We're small. We're not job creators. We can do things like put incentives out there, like an enterprise zone or an A&E district. But at the end of the day, we don't have, at least in Chestertown, a ton of cash to get these started. And sometimes that's what it takes is a corporation like that or some group that's whose mission is to look out for these types of projects and then fund them with seed money. That would be exciting to me if that could happen.
So the other thing that I think really makes a town, and this really comes back to Washington College, is you know, it's great to have young entrepreneurs
and
those who have decided that they want to stay in a place like Chestertown. Is there a way or is there programs now going on at Washington College that could encourage that?
Yeah, Michael Harvey's been doing some good things in that area, and I would love to expand those. I think the you know, the fact that the county is laying all this cable for really high capacity, high speed internet and Wi-Fi services is very important, because I do think that's another component of growth in these rural areas. Is the more you can get, you know, it's people who are consultants or there's so much you can do remotely now, and this is such a lovely area to live. So yes, we do. I know we place a lot of interns in some of the small businesses there. We have a lot of students who are interested in starting a business. I hate to come back to my favorite topic, but student debt is an impediment. And there's actually the Philadelphia Federal Reserve did an interesting study about a year or two on this that showed that all the student debt is actually impeding small business formation, because students used to be, when they graduated, entrepreneurial students, they'd start they go out and borrow a little money and start a business in a garage or what have you, and now they're graduating with $30,000 or $40,000 of debt. They can't borrow more money. Nobody's going to lend it to them, so they're going to go work for a larger corporation, get that steady paycheck to pay it back. So I do think this financial debt, this student debt problem has spillover impacts that you wouldn't even think intuitively, but yeah, I think we could do more of that. I think we have a number of partnerships with local businesses now. Love to expand them. It's great for the students. I really want to put an emphasis on job preparedness for our students or someone to go to graduate or professional school and help them with that next step. But just make sure that we're providing all the support we can, so that when they're ready to enter the labor force, they're well prepared. And you know, liberal arts college is so great, just in terms of the critical thinking skills, the analytical skills, the writing communication skills that you garner with the liberal arts college. But to complement that with real world job shadowing or internships or apprenticeships is just a very powerful combination.
Fair enough. My last question, and then we'd like to open it up to the audience. But as my editorial last week indicated, these Chestertown and Washington College have had a terrific long-term relationship. For years, the mayor of the town served on the board of visitor governors. What do you think about that?
So that is, I saw that in, I will tell you, I am not the chair of the board. I'm not the chair of the trustees committee. So I'm not sure I want to foray into who should and should not be on our board. You know, if it's a discussion you'd like us to have with the board, we could. How long ago was that? Did it work well? Do you know when it was?
Joe? Like
the 1500s, maybe?
Not since 1990.
I was thinking Margo Bailey in the audience. But anyway, I would say that when I was here in the 1980s.
Well, could I get on the city council?
What's that?
Could I get on the city council?
I don't know if you want that, actually.
Would you want to be on the
How many extra board? Meetings is that going to be?
Well, I was going to say that's the first one that you're going to bring up. But it opens up this whole door of, you know, how do you formally work together?
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't have to be a board member, I guess, but I think the idea is how do you formalize it? I know that you are meeting for coffee occasionally. Right. I think, there's so many moving parts.
Yeah, there are. I mean, I think probably, look, our board deals with, you know, tuition and academic programming and student affairs, and I mean, I think a lot of stuff that really would not be of interest to the leader of a town. So, I don't know. I think it's working pretty well now. Again, I'm open to structures. We'll get an advisory committee maybe to the board if people thought that would be helpful. But I think, to Chris's point, there's so much going on now that you want to be careful you're not going to duplicate and just create more bureaucracy on something that where I think we are. I was so pleased with the marina funding and so excited about that. And I think that was a really good example and a base that we can keep working together and hopefully have more successes like that.
You feel the same way you feel?
I do, yeah. And I do agree that while it sounds really cool for me to be on the board of a college, they would be talking about a lot of things that frankly, as much as I love the college, I don't want to be sitting through a meeting about like tuition increases and decreases.
Yeah.
So. I think you can do it informally as long as it's consistent and you're both open and honest about what's going on. And I think it's also important that if there's a disagreement that you don't have to be disagreeable. You know, we can just come from different angles and say, hey, this is a problem for me because of this, or this is what we can do and this is what we probably couldn't do for you. So I have a pretty good relationship with Sheila, and also have a pretty good relationship with the current chairman of the Board of Trustees. So I feel like that's about all I really need at this point.
Could you envision a scenario where we could there could be some kind of what they call fast-tracking projects that take kind of some of the unknown out of process of permitting?
I think there's a little bit of disinformation, to be honest, out there about how onerous it is to get something approved through our planning commission. I was on the planning commission for many, many years, and if people come and they've looked at our comp plan and they have a good plan that aligns with what we requested in the comp plan, it really isn't that onerous of a process. And when you start fast-tracking for individual entities, you really open up a can of worms, to be honest, where like then John Doe taxpayer says, I want to be fast-tracked for my garage that you are giving me a hard time about. So there's a lot of legal issues that are kind of subtle that I don't think a lot of people appreciate. Like the Wawa is a great example. Like you can't legally just flip the zoning of one property for an entity so they can sell it more easily. That's called spot zoning, and that's a problem for the town. It has to be done when the zoning is examined comprehensively. And for every person that loves Wawa, there's going to be another person yelling at me going, why are you letting another convenience store set up on a major intersection? So for me, it's like, it's a can of worms, to be honest. And I understand the financial incentives, but, you know, there's got to be a little yin and yang, but you have to be very careful legally and ethically when it comes to things like changing zoning.
I'd like to open it up to the audience for folks who have questions, and I believe we have someone who will be able to hand a mic over to the questioner. If you could identify yourselves with raising of hands.
Don't all jump at once. Oh,
there's a couple coming up. Gina, right in the middle, right?
President Blair mentioned it very briefly about fiber being into the town. My question, I have basically two questions. First of all, is the college participating by having the fiber being brought to the campus? And number two, for the town, is there any way that you can get the fiber into the downtown, which is where we want new businesses to start up? Of course, fiber would just be a tremendous benefit. But my understanding is that the fiber people want to go underground.
So I think we're only kind of tangentially involved. They're actually using the armory now to store their cable. I don't know. We've got our great staff here. If you all have any other perspectives on that in terms of our involvement.
The college has had high-speed access through a University of Maryland co-op. So what we've been doing with FSI has been to...
It looks good, doesn't it?
The college is working with FSI by giving them right-of-ways through our campus and to the hotspot that we have behind on Brown Street, connecting into a larger network for redundancy purposes. So we're working with them collaboratively to facilitate the network they're installing. And then we're also permitting them to utilize the armory as a staging site for the entire county. But we've had high speed for some time through the University of Maryland network system that runs a spine up the Eastern Shore.
So I'm not the best person to answer this because I don't know the exact route, but they are planning on bringing fiber downtown. And so the last discussion I had with FTS was that they were going to be running the lines behind the storefronts on High Street because there were so many impediments in the way to run underground cable in front of the stores. So it is coming. And yes, we're going to be involved. And I agree with you. Like, it opens up a whole new world of, you know, small tech-type businesses, which is, I believe, what the county is hoping for. But it also just improve internet services for everybody downtown, which is sorely needed, and we all know that.
Thank you. I'm Margot Tillman from Queen Street. We talk about growth, and one of the things that comes to mind for me in a room full of mostly gray-haired people is what's the appeal to younger families, and particularly a big piece of that is this public school system. And could you speak to that for me, please?
I'll give it my best shot. It's a tricky issue for me. I'm the mayor of Chestertown, and I'm not the mayor of the county. So it's a county-run school system. So a lot of people ask me during the campaign, what are you going to do to improve the school system? And to be really candid with you, like, the town really doesn't have almost any role in how the school system is run. We support our local schools. You know, we raise that money to fix up the campus. But in terms of what actually happens in the schools themselves, it's a county-run system. So it's a little tricky. It's tricky for us. And I agree with you. One of the first things I'm sure your faculty ask when they're looking for where to live
schools,
is, what's the school system like? I have a kid in the school system, a ninth grader, and he's having a great experience. So I do think there's a lot of negative press out there about the school system that isn't necessarily always warranted. Yes, there can be some tricky kids in our public school system, but show me a public school system where that's not the case. It certainly was where I went to school in Fairfax County, Virginia, which is one of the best public school systems in the country. So, you know, I think for the young people that come here, my experience has been, because I came here as a young person, I loved the lifestyle, I loved the access to the water, I loved the environment. Those are the kinds of people that you're going to need. The young folks that come are the kind of folks that like the slower pace, like the small town lifestyle, like knowing the person down the street or the person behind the counter at the coffee shop. So I think it's more of a lifestyle choice, and they adapt, they make it work. I know that my wife and I did. And I don't think that there's no hope to bring young people here. I don't agree with that at all. And I am, again, cautiously optimistic that the fiber That's the kind of thing that could bring a telecommuting young mom and dad into Chestertown. They have a little boat. They want to get on the river every day. They don't want to go into D.C. They can work remotely. That's why the fiber, to me, is so potentially exciting. I'm a believe-it-when-I-see-it kind of guy, but it's certainly, the infrastructure is certainly has that potential.
How about your thoughts about...
Well, you know, it is, I just agree with what Chris said. I think it's a common question. I think there's a perception that's not fair, that the Kent County schools are weak. I think you've got a very dynamic new superintendent. We had her to campus last year, and she's been, all the metrics are on the right trajectory there. So I think that's, I certainly encourage faculty and staff, we don't require it, but if to live here and try out the schools. Because I do think it's a problem. It's a problem. It's in a negative cycle, and the more families move outside the county, the weaker the system becomes because they don't have the student body. So, but I'm very impressed with her, and so I think it's we encourage people to stay here, live here if they can, and certainly not be guided by a decision on where the schools are.
I think it's worth noting that I think 35 teachers in our system here are Washington College graduates.
Right. So that's great.
That's a good sign.
That's a big number.
Very good sign.
There's a couple of...
Oh, yeah, thank you. Many colleges and universities throughout the country make payments to their local governing body called pilot programs, payment in lieu of taxes. Probably the college is the largest landowner in the town. What sort of negotiations are going on that would have the college financially support the town?
You had to go there, didn't you?
I did have to go there.
Well, there are none. Look, I think we are trying very hard to make our college more affordable. I think, assessing students a dollar amount would not help us. I don't think it would help us with recruitment. I don't think it would help us with family perception about what they're paying for. We do want to partner with the town on growth opportunities. I think, again, it gets the question, you want to redefine the pie or do you want to try to grow the pie for everyone? So I'm very uncomfortable with it. We did some analysis last year when it came up. I believe most of the schools that had that were, first of all, wealthier than we are and are in larger urban areas where the value of the land was really quite much more significant. I do want to emphasize that if the land we own, if it's not used for educational purposes, we do pay taxes. So Joe, I don't know what the exact dollar amount is, but we do. It's not that everything we own is tax-free. That's tax exempt. That's not the case. It's only the land where we have educational usage that we have this, and that's true of any nonprofit. And I do think it's I kind of the other question is, well, why? This is a standard benefit for nonprofits and. You're asking us, but you're not asking the other nonprofits here, and I'm not suggesting that. I just think that's the wrong way to look at this, that I think that's a divisive issue that would not go well with our students and families, which is counterproductive for everybody, and I think it distracts from really great areas where we can work together, like getting $500,000, extra dollars out of the Senate capital budget for the marina.
It's a very tough issue for me because any pilot payment that a college makes is voluntary. It has to come from them. Like, I can pick that fight, but if they just say, hey, we feel like we do enough, I mean, I'm just going to be ripping open a wound every time I do it and exacerbating relationships to the negative side of the spectrum. I do think the college, they do uniquely put some stress on our infrastructure. There, no other nonprofit has 1,400 18 to 22-year-old kids living in town for 8 months out of the year. So I don't feel like it's apples and apples comparing the college to, River Arch or another nonprofit. So, if you think of the 1,400 kids and how often our police are responding to calls for off-campus parties or just the traffic that generates coming into and out of the campus on a daily basis, it's significant. So I don't think that the discussion is without merit. But again, I also have to respect the fact that the college is a huge asset for Chestertown. They're our largest employer. They have this gorgeous campus that's meticulously maintained. They have special events like you're sitting in right now that are an incredible quality of life addition for all of our residents. They bring people that retire here largely because there's a college. So I do think overall the economic benefits way outweigh the lack of a pilot payment. And if the college is willing to go to bat for us when we really need funding, like for the marina, then I do agree with Sheila that that could be a way to kind of avoid this kind of annual fee, but maybe on an opportunistic level we could work together if they could help us raise money for important projects that we both feel are important. So it's a tough one. It's a tough one for me. Like, it's a PR nightmare that I'm only going to lose, and I got to pick my battles.
We have a couple more questions up there. Mike, people.
I don't know who you're pointing to. I know the person on my left also has a question. sorry.
Twofer.
I know that the University of Maryland Medical Center was very impressed by the number of people who came out in opposition to the potential closure of the hospital. But there is, of course, all over the country, great consolidation of hospitals and larger ones eating up smaller ones, and rural hospitals closing. And I'm wondering if there's a role for Washington College and the town itself, as well as Heron Point, to try to stay ahead of it. I know that they were impressed in the first instance by the 800 people, but this trend is an unmistakable trend. And I wonder if there's a strategy to counter that trend or how you are working on the issue of the hospital.
That's another really tricky one for me because, again, the hospital is in Chestertown, but it's a regional hospital. So I feel like that battle is better fought, you know, not to duck out of the battle. I'm actually going to fight to maintain. Really what it's about is maintaining inpatient beds at the end of the day and not having it be a freestanding medical facility like a glorified ER. So I'll do everything I can to advocate to keep those services. But I really need, that's an issue where I need the commissioners to be fighting with me. I need our state delegation to be fighting with me because it's way bigger than Chestertown. And when we are unified, and the college was very proactive speaking at the meeting, they've come to several of the meetings of the doctors. And again, I just think the most critical thing as a county is to show a unified front, starting with the mayor up to the state delegation, including our large employers. And if we can continue to do that, ultimately, it's probably going to come down to a negotiation of how many inpatient beds is the state willing to subsidize, if you believe the figures on the P&L statements and whatnot. So it's a really critical issue. And again, it's a little frustrating for me because I don't control what UMMS does, but we can put as much PR pressure. And that was the beauty of that meeting. We intentionally scheduled it at the fire hall, hoping that way too many people would show up. Because it created one hell of a spectacle. It was on the cover of every regional paper, and that's the kind of thing UMMS really hates. So that was a check in our box.
Yeah, we were all in on that too, and sent out, you know, a lot. There were a lot of Washington College people at that event, and I've personally spoken against it to people in Annapolis. I think it's would be devastating. And we use that hospital. We send, you know, we use the inpatient services. We use the outpatient services. And we've told them we're happy to work with them to see if we can give them more business. You know, I've offered, you know, they can do a health fair on campus. I mean, we're happy to try to do things that will make their economics work better. I got to tell you, I worry about whether the will's there. You know, we kind of make these offers, and you would think they would be wanting to drum up business, but, you know, if your mindset is, well, we want to close this, maybe they don't want to show that there's bigger volume. So I think we need to be very vigilant on that issue and continue to speak up about it. And Chris is absolutely right. This is bigger than Chestertown. But the support of our state legislators is absolutely essential.
And I will say they have been very proactive as well.
Yeah. We have a couple more questions in that midsection, I believe. Anyone else?
we've got to be careful about her.
Is this on? I'm Wendy Costa, and I wanted to address the question about the schools. I'm a member of the school board. I can't speak for the school board just as an individual, but We really have some very exciting things going on in our schools, and I was happy to see refer to our school superintendent in glowing terms. She's probably the best school superintendent anywhere. I have seen school superintendents in Texas and in California, worked very closely with them, and honestly, we have the best school superintendent certainly in the state. And it takes a while to turn a school system around, but that is in fact happening. I would like to see more connection between Washington College and the school system. We're very happy to hire students, but mentor programs, there are connections that can be made that I think we're missing. But for people who haven't been in our schools for a while, come check them out. I think you'd be very pleased what you see.
Thanks. Mine was not really a question either. Like Wendy, I wanted to come to the defense of the local schools. I've been involved with them a lot. The information that the schools are a problem here, that's several years old. There was a long time where we went through a new principal every year. We haven't done that for a number of years. This past weekend, Kent County Public Schools came in fourth in the state in the Science Olympiad. It was just a great outpouring of brilliant kids, and they had a science fair last night. Right now, the school has really never had a forum to communicate the great things that are going on. The college has been a part of that. They can get credits, they can do the AP kids, can do classes at Washington College. Mentors from Washington College work with the Bayside Hoyas group to help them with their homework, to help them tutor them through their classes. It's been a really great relationship. And the whole schools, we need to stop saying there's a problem, because there's not. The school's doing really well, and our rankings across the state have really come up. So that's old story, and we really need to let it go. The other thing is the hospital, and certainly Sheila Bair has written some wonderful editorials on that and has been very involved, as have all our legislators. And we had a meeting last week, and that's looking good too. As Easton, which is going to be a long time before Easton's there, they're going to be taking all of Cambridge's patients. And for University of Maryland, with that new influx of patients there, it's seeming that they have been very positive lately about they really need this hospital on this end of their area. So it's looking very good right now. The work groups' deliberations are ongoing. They've been very positive. I think I just felt that we needed to address two of the questions that came up that still have a bit of a negative spin that has really turned around a lot recently. A lot of good work from everybody on the stage here. So, no question. Thank you.
Okay. Hi, am I on? Yeah. I'm Gil Shellis, and a couple things. One, my experience in life is perception sometimes becomes reality, and so to go to the points of what you're saying, that education has improved and yet the perception is that it hasn't, and so that sea change needs to be communicated so that people understand that it's not a bad environment, it's a good one. And Chestertown is such a wonderful respite. It has got such a unique offering. It's commuting ability just, again, getting away from that. So I guess what my question is I hear that you have a marketing department group for the Chestertown town, and then you have one for the county. But did you ever think about using that wonderful asset of that youthful brain trust you have? And do you offer marketing at this college? Is that part of the curriculum?
Well, we actually are launching a communications major in the fall, which will have a marketing marketing component to
so
it.
So my brain was just like, put them to task at developing a marketing program for the in-town, for communication to the schools, communication about the hospital. Put that youthful brain trust, because that's who we're trying to attract, is put them in charge of and make it a competition.
Right.
And maybe the town can offer some incentive for that competition for those grades. So it's just, I thought, we've got it here. Why not take advantage of it?
Sure.
And just build it into the curriculum. Each year, they come up with a more creative idea how to bring people into Chestertown, how to communicate how good it really is.
All right. Interesting suggestion. Thank you. Well, it'd certainly be good if not just building the curriculum, a good project to market Chestertown. I like that. That's a good idea.
We had a couple more.
Glenn.
Is there anything on the radar, either of your radars, about a conference center, hotel, either private or part of college in your visions?
It's definitely on the radar. I know on our Main Street program, they have basically come to the conclusion that that would be a great asset for the town. And it's really a matter of where should it go? How do you find the entrepreneur that's going to put up the capital to get that going? Is the P&L going to work out? So I think the town is very intrigued by the idea and supportive of the idea, but we can wish for something till we're blue in the face, and if it doesn't work economically, it's not going to happen. So I think it's in the preliminary stages. I know that the Main Street folks are in exploring people to talk to that could potentially make that happen. But if there was a proposal that made sense, I would be absolutely fired up to have that happen. It's just a matter of finding the person or the investors willing to take that step.
Yeah. No, I think so. We would certainly be open if a hotel developer wanted to use that to buy the armory. That would be, I assume the town would be supportive of that. Because it's an historic structure and you've got some limitations what you can do. They may or may not be an attractive development opportunity for an hotelier, so, which is also why we're trying to think of other options. And I don't know if we're going to do a residence hall, but I think one thing, if we did that, we want to vet that with a lot of people and talk with students. But in the summer, I would love to have executive conferences. You know, I know a lot of people in the corporate community, so does my board. It'd be a perfect place for corporate retreats, executive education. You know, we have a fabulous thing called Chesapeake Summer for our students. We're thinking maybe we could do a mini Chesapeake Summer for alums and things and use that as a potential facility. So that would, again, it's a kind of mixed-use idea, but it would bring traffic to Chestertown in the summer. And maybe another thing to think about, because I'm not sure how attractive the Armory will be for a hotel, but we're certainly very open to it. We would love to solicit interest in that, but we'll just see if it really, as you say, if the economics work for that use, or if a better location would be.
I have anyway, so. A question for one more. Carla, could you wait for the mic?
You're totally cool.
Thank you. I want to pick up on the comment about perception, and I think it's very important because I think some really wonderful things have happened in this town with the college, with the town, with private citizens, and you look to the hospital, it wouldn't happen without private citizens stepping forward, without various groups getting together, and I think we do that particularly well. And I think we need to do more of it, but we do it particularly well. I think the waterfront has become a real example of that. You know, the town has had its significant part. The college has been pursuing the boathouse. They're down there anyway on Wilmer Park. We've had private citizens who were instrumental in getting that last little bit of land and that strip. So it's really been a wonderful collaborative way of looking at one of the greatest assets the town has, the college has, and we, people who love it here, have. So I'd give a big cheer, if I would, to all of you. We're getting ready to have this fabulous first major arts project completed in May, Project Broadreach. I think the name of it alone speaks to where we can go in this community, having the broader reach, reaching out and embracing one another and thinking about our future together. So I kind of a big cheer to all of you, and a big cheer to everybody in this audience, because this shows the commitment and the caring that we have. So thank you.
Thank you very much. We have to cut it off at this point, but I can't thank you enough.
No problem.
Mr. Mayor, Madam.
My pleasure. It was great. Thank you for sponsoring.
And hopefully we can come back next year and
there
see where
go.
We
Make
are.
It an annual event.
Is that all right? Okay.
Sure.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.